In 1967, an inspired venture capitalist whispered a word of wisdom to a young Dustin Hoffman in the movie The Graduate. That word, plastics. Plastics, they're all around us. From cell phones to water bottles, plastics are a large part of our lives. A symbol of the modern age and innovation, virtually unknown a century ago, they're now all around us. But plastics, they're made from petrochemicals, from oil. And we need to face up to the fact that we are trashing our planet and our own health from the production and disposal of plastic goods. In order to produce plastic, we pump oil out of fossil reservoirs. We burn a portion of this ancient carbon to transform this petroleum to refineries. Refineries burn this, again, this oil, to convert a portion of it to plastics. And these plastics, they're all around us. Evidence of them show up in our blood, breast milk, and tissues. And these plastics have chemicals found in these synthetic plastics have shown to have negative correlations, negative health effects on our neurological, endocrine, and reproductive systems. Plastics are all around us. They are and they're also found in remote locations in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, thousands of miles away from land. I've seen cows chomping on plastic bags on the streets of India. And I've also seen plastics on remote Hawaiian beaches and also lining the shores of Mexico. Plastics do have some benefits, but they also bring a dire set of whole system dangers. And unless we can address these dangers, these problems are going to continue to rise with the global increasing demand of plastics. Plastics do look cheap, but the consequences they have on our health, on not just our health, but on plants and animals, and on this planet are substantial. So how can we make an impact on this growing global problem? Can we redesign the cycle of plastics to still have their benefits, but also address these environmental dangers? What would this world look like? Well, first off, plastics are made all over the world. So this plastic technology would have to be able to be used in remote locations and near population centers. Secondly, ideal plastics would be biodegradable. A lot of these plastics, they're only used one time, very briefly, such as in food packaging, and then they're disposed of. So the ideal replacement plastic should be biodegradable to be able to address these concerns. And thirdly, this plastic must be able to compete economically. It must be cheap. So what can we do about this? Today, I'm going to tell you about some of nature's smallest workers. A powerful yet profoundly robust partner, bacteria. There's an enormous quantity of bacteria found in nature. Name any key biological function, and inevitably, there's a community of bacteria that specialize in performing that key function. My favorite friends are bacteria that consume methane. They consume methane, which is a potent greenhouse gas, over 20 times more harmful than carbon dioxide. And what's really great about these bacteria is they're kind of like us. They like to party when times are good. When they have a good place to live and plenty of food to eat, they do what comes natural. They chow down, reproduce, and get fat. In our lab, we use more technical terms. The bacteria consume a nutrient, methane, increase in population, divide, and accumulate a carbon source, a biopolymer. So the bacteria do this by consuming methane, a potent greenhouse gas, and using a naturally occurring process. These bacteria, I might also mention, are not currently genetically modified. Using this microbial process, they produce this biopolymer. This biopolymer can be harvested and sold to those who make plastic products. When these plastic products end up in certain environments where no oxygen's present, like our anaerobic digesters at wastewater treatment plants or landfills, they can biodegrade anaerobically to produce more methane, creating a closed-loop process. And this process, if you use methane gas, waste methane, you can require no external energy source to do this, and very minimal water. This biopolymer that's produced, it's called polyhydroxyalkalate, or PHA, and it's part of a large and rapidly growing market. But current PHAs are very expensive. PHAs are a class of biopolyesters. They're thermoplastics, and they have very unique properties. Unlike other bioplastics that you might hear about out there, like polylactic acid, PHAs have really unique heat and moisture properties. Also, they have really great biodegradation properties as well. So if they end up in the ocean, they will biodegrade there. They'll biodegrade anaerobically, where no oxygen is present. This is very unique for a biopolymer. Now, you might be wondering, why isn't anybody else doing this? Well, methane utilizers are just a small class of the vast bacteria population. Most research focuses on sugar, which is very readily available. And most microbiologists think that feeding anything other than sugar is pretty crazy. But when you compare sugar to methane, especially on a pound per pound basis, methane is significantly more affordable. We're so excited about the capabilities these small 1 micron bacteria have to change the world of plastics as we know it, that we've started a company called Mango Materials to commercialize this technology. This work was part of my PhD research at Stanford, and we're really excited about the possibilities of making very affordable bioplastics that have excellent applications. Now, you might also be wondering, why aren't large chemical companies doing this? What about large plastic companies? Well, it's a little bit like 1947, before the invention of modern electronics. Looking at a clunky transistor and introducing that to a skeptical world dominated by vacuum tubes. The current wisdom at the time correctly pointed out that the current vacuum tubes were cheaper, faster, and more reliable. Well, petroleum-based companies are invested in mature technologies of petrorefinery. These are large-scale issues. In contrast, we are advocating a new field of industrial microbiology. We know that this process works. It's more than just a fun theoretical science experiment. We feed our bacteria methane. They grow. We've scaled up 10,000-fold from microliters to tens of liters. In the field, using waste methane from anaerobic biodegradation and propagating our bacteria for over 200 generations. That's more than 2 months. And we're faced by lots of wisdom that other people think we can't overachieve. Oh, you can't scale up this technology. Why would you feed bacteria methane? How are you gonna have to sterilize the tanks daily? Why aren't you feeding them sugar? We acknowledge these limitations, but we've constantly been knocking them down. We need to partner with existing methane producers to scale this technology. We envision this technology to be able to be located where the methane's produced, all over the world, having hundreds of plastic production facilities where the plastic can be produced near where it's used. This will allow less transportation, which will mean less environmental impacts. We also need to confirm that the mass transfer of getting the methane into solution can be cost competitive at scale. And we need to confirm that the biological process works very, very efficiently and also at scale, and that we have the ideal downstream configurations for the processing. In the general field of biomaterials, we need to confirm that these technologies, not just this one, but other similar biomaterial technologies, don't require too much water, too much energy, or inadvertently harm the natural biodiversity found on this planet. Current plastics made from petroleum are not long-term solutions, but bioplastics can change that. For every ton of bioplastic that we produce, 10 tons of CO2 worth of equivalents can be saved. That's like taking 10% of all automobiles off the planet. And if we can, it's been shown that biodegradable plastics can replace 30% of all plastics in the world. And at that scale, we would be saving over 500 million tons of carbon dioxide worth of equivalents. I want to alert you to the fact that we are on the cusp of the environmental microbiological revolution. And yes, there's work to be done. We need to scale this technology. That's the key right now that we're trying to do. At my company, we just recently won this week a grant from the National Science Foundation, a Phase 2 award. So we have more funding with the possibility of additional matching funds. But how do we use this money to very rapidly scale this technology? We need to scale quickly, and we need to scale economically. How do we do that? There's a lot of work to be done. This technology that I spoke about today is just one of a possible solution to solve the problem of the way we produce and use plastics. And yes, there's lots of challenges, but we're striving to overcome them. In the meantime, I'd like you to all think about plastics in your everyday lives. Do you really need that single-use plastic water bottle? Think about where that ancient carbon came from and at what environmental cost its production required. Now, think about a world where that water bottle does not represent an environmental burden, but is rather part of an integral solution to solve global climate change and change the fate of plastics in our environment. Thank you.